Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Abhishek Verma, and I'm here to talk about how we are running Cassandra on Apache Mesos across multiple data centers at Uber. So a little bit about myself first. I finished my MS and PhD in computer science from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And my work was basically on performance modeling of MapReduce environments. Then I spent a couple of years at Google, where I was working on Borg. So Borg is the cluster scheduling infrastructure that is used at Google and has been used for the past decade. And I also worked on Omega, which is supposed to be the successor of Borg. And I'm also the first author of the Borg paper. After that, I spent a year at TCS Research in Mumbai, where I was working on performance modeling of Hive environments. And currently now I'm working at Uber, and we are trying to run Cassandra on top of Mesos. So let's start from the ground up. What is Uber trying to do? So the mission of Uber is to make transportation as reliable as running water everywhere and for everyone. So we want to make transportation very reliable. We want four nines of availability. So we want 99.99% of availability so that it can be as reliable as running water, which means that among 10,000 requests, only one can fail, or we can get an unavailability exception only for one out of 10,000 requests. To get such a kind of availability, we have to make sure that our applications are running in multiple data centers, because if your application is running only in one data center, then some people might not be able to take, some riders may not be able to take trips, or drivers may not be able to go online, and so on. So if in case there's a power failure, for example, or some other problems in the data center, we need to have a backup data center or multiple backups in different data centers running at the same time. Also, to make transportation for everyone, it has to be efficient. So we need to squeeze out the efficiencies from our systems. And for that reason, we're trying to use Mesos. So this is the state of cluster management at Uber. In the beginning, we had statically partitioned machines across different services. So for example, if we had 1,000 machines, 50 of them were for the API, or 50 of them for storage, and so on. And they didn't intersect at all. We had statically partitioned machines. But now we are trying to move from this custom deployment system to everything running on Mesos, so that a single machine can be running services of different kinds. So we can gain a lot of efficiency by increasing the machine utilization, by co-locating services on the same machine. So for example, if a service is using a lot of CPU, but there's another service which is using a lot of storage, disk space, or memory, these two can be co-located on the same machine. This will drive up the machine utilization and increase our efficiencies. So I wrote a paper at Google about Borg, which was the large-scale cluster management at Google with Borg, in which we did an experiment. So at Google, we have a lot of shared clusters. They run production and batch workloads on the same cluster. We did an experiment where we simulated two different clusters, one which was running the production services and one which was running the batch workloads. And we compared this with a shared cluster. And what we figured out is that we would need 30% more machines if we separated out the workloads. So by statistically multiplexing different workloads on the same machine, we are reducing the number of machines required by about 30%. And that is why at Uber, we're trying to run everything on top of Mesos and also build stateful service frameworks for running Cassandra, for example, Kafka, or other things on top of Mesos. So to give a little background about Mesos, and by the way, if you have any questions, please interrupt me at any time, and I would repeat the question, and I'll try to answer it for that. I would like to make this as interactive as possible for everyone. So a little brief background about Mesos. Mesos abstracts CPU, memory, and storage away from machines. So you're not looking at individual machines, but you're looking at a pool of resources. And you can program as if it's a single pool of resources. It provides linear scalability It has been demonstrated to run on tens of thousands of machines, for example, at Twitter. It's highly available. It uses Zookeeper, for example, for leader election, amongst its configurable number of replicas for the Mesos master. There's also native support for launching containers. So you can launch Docker containers, or there's a Mesos containerizer as well, which you can run on top of Mesos. There's different pluggable resource isolation techniques. So for example, there's a C groups CPU isolator or memory isolator, which works on Linux. There's a POSIX isolator as well. And there are different isolation mechanisms for different OSs as well. And Mesos does two-level scheduling. So the resources from the Mesos agents are sent and are offered to different frameworks. And the frameworks then schedule their own tasks on top of these offers. So there's like a two-level scheduling that happens in Mesos. So we're trying to run Cassandra on top of Mesos. So this would be preaching to the choir about what are the different good qualities of Cassandra that made us a very good fit for use cases at Uber. Horizontal scalability. So you can scale reads and writes linearly as new nodes are added. High availability. So we have fault tolerance with tunable consistency levels. We get low latency and solid performance. So for example, we are getting sub-millisecond latencies for the same data center. Also, it's operationally simple because it's a homogeneous cluster. There's no master node, there's no special nodes in the cluster. It also provides rich data model for our purposes. So we have columns, composite keys, counters, secondary indexes, and so on. It also has very good integration with open source software. For example, Hadoop, Spark, and Hive all have connectors to talk to Cassandra. So because of this, we are trying to run, we started a collaboration with Mesosphere, and we built a Mesos framework. So it's open source, and it's available at GitHub, at github.com/mesosphere/DCS-Cassandra-service. And I would like to call out a few people who worked on this. From the Mesosphere side, we had Chris, Gabriel, Keith, Kenneth, and Mohit. I think some of them might be present here. I don't see them here. But and from Uber, we had me, Karthik, Matthias, Varun, Zuitao, and Jian. And we all worked together to implement this framework and design it. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Go on. Yes. So Cassandra and Mesos have completely different designs. In Mesos, we have Mesos master. So I'll go to this figure and I'll explain that. So in Mesos, there is like a notion of a master and different agents. But there's multiple replicas of masters as well. And they all talk to Zookeeper for leader election. And Zookeeper also has replicas. So essentially, it is highly available, but it does have a master-slave kind of architecture. But it leads to high availability in any case. There are different design decisions, but they work together well. Any other questions before I move on? Yes? Why did we not pick Yarn? So Yarn, as far as I know, is pretty specific to Hadoop and Hadoop-like workloads. So for example, Mesos can launch Docker containers, which I don't think Yarn can. So at Uber, we are trying to run, for example, web services or the dispatch services inside Docker containers on top of Mesos, which Yarn does not support. So that's why we picked Mesos. Yes, it's probably simpler. We actually had the person who wrote Nomad come and give a talk at Uber. As far as I understand, it's not very mature yet. It hasn't been demonstrated to run on thousands or tens of thousands of machines, which was the requirement at Uber. So we are running at a pretty large scale at Uber, and we wanted something that was tested and proven to be scalable to that level. That's why we didn't pick Nomad. Sure, I could answer it in person later on, or I'll take those at the end if we have time. Sorry. So here's the Cassandra service architecture. At the top, we have the web interface or the control plane API. So it exposes a REST interface where you can submit a put request or a post request to create a new cluster. So you specify how many nodes you want, how many seed nodes are going to be in the cluster, different Cassandra configurations, and you submit it to this control plane API, which launches, using the deployment system at Uber, a framework on top of Aurora. So Aurora is also another framework which we are using currently to run stateless services. So we also use that to bootstrap our framework. So here the framework DCOS Cassandra service, for example, is shown to have two clusters, cluster one in red and cluster two in green. It talks to the Mesos master, one of which is the leader, and there are multiple standbys. For example, in our configuration, we have five Mesos masters, and they use Zookeeper for leader election. We also use Zookeeper for storing metadata about the framework. So for example, which tasks are running, what the Cassandra configurations are, what is the health of the cluster, and so on. Question is it DSE or open source Cassandra? We are using the open source Cassandra version. Currently it's 2.2.5, but we're also going to support 3.0.6, I think. There's also a different branch of the DCOS Cassandra service, which Mesosphere maintains, which supports DSE. So there's also DataStax support available. So what happens is there are different Mesos agents which are running on every machine in the cluster. And these Mesos agents provide the resources to the Mesos master, and the Mesos master doles them out in discrete offers. And these offers can be either accepted or rejected by the framework. And for example, you can have multiple Cassandra nodes running on the same machine. So in this example, the cluster one is running 1A, 1B, and 1C on the three Mesos agents, whereas cluster two is running 2A and 2B on those two Mesos agents. So we can have multiple clusters running at the same time. Why are we running Cassandra in containers? There was a good point that was made earlier, which was that you might want to give the entire machine to Cassandra. But for a lot of use cases at Uber, for example, you're trying to store hundreds of gigabytes of data, but you want it replicated on multiple machines and also across data centers. And you want resource isolation as well as performance isolation across different clusters. It's very hard to get that in a single shared cluster. So for example, if you made a 1,000-node Cassandra cluster, it would either not scale or it would also have performance, interference across different clusters. I think the main goal is agility. We have more than 20 clusters right now, and we are going to have around 100 clusters, 100 different Cassandra clusters. So we want to manage these clusters and be able to do different operations on them in a smooth manner. Performance is not such a huge design goal. I'll have some numbers about that as well. How much does the container add to the performance overhead? Mesos is the container orchestration platform. We actually wrote the framework. The framework is the orchestrator which talks to Mesos and schedules these. I'll show a demo of this and how we actually run this. Yes, we are using the Mesos containerizer for the Cassandra process.
So does it handle replication across the rack or the zone?
Yes. Does it handle replication across racks or zones? Yes. The Mesos agent actually exposes the rack attribute, which rack it belongs to, and we also have a configurable data center attribute, which we write in the configuration, which is used to launch the Cassandra process. So Cassandra does the rack awareness and the data center application as well. We are using the Mesos containerizer. What we do is we override the different 5 ports in configuration. These are the 5 ports which have the default values, but we override them so that we can run multiple containers on the same machine. We use persistent volumes, which are an abstraction provided by Mesos, so that the data is stored outside the sandbox directory. So in case a Cassandra task fails, you still have the data in the persistent volume, which is offered to the same task if it crashes and restarts. We also use dynamic reservation to make sure that resources are available so that you can launch a failed task. We wrote a custom seed provider so that we can launch different Cassandra nodes. So here I'm going to provide an illustration. Suppose we want to start a cluster with 3 nodes. And what we did was we exposed a scheduler REST endpoint, so say scheduler/seeds, which tells you what are the seed nodes. So for example, in the blank, in a fresh, completely new cluster, node 1 is coming up, is starting up. It hits the REST endpoint and asks, what are the seeds? So since the cluster is completely new, what it says is, you are a seed, that is seed is equal to true, and there are no seeds in the cluster right now. So this makes node 1 a seed. So the green nodes are the non-seed nodes, and the orange nodes are the seed nodes. So node 1 becomes a seed now. Now node 2 comes up, and since we are going to have 2 nodes, which are going to be the seed nodes, when the node 2 hits the REST endpoint, it says there's 1 seed right now in the cluster, 10.0.0.1, and is seed is true, which means you're also a seed. And it bootstraps as a seed node. So we have 2 nodes in orange. When the third node starts up, which is not going to be a seed node, it asks the scheduler endpoint, and it gets is seed is false. So you're not a seed, and these are the 2 seeds in the cluster. So in this way, we can roll out Cassandra nodes automatically, and seed nodes can be configured through this custom seed provider. In the YAML, what we mention is that this is the DCOS seed provider, and we give it a parameter, which is this URL. And Cassandra has an interface, which basically says, okay, get seed nodes is the function, and get seed nodes can be implemented in any way you want. So the way we implement it is do a get request to this URL and fetch the seeds. If all the nodes were bootstrapped at one point of time and they were brought down and then brought up again, the seed nodes would be the same. And the REST endpoint would say those were the 2 seed nodes, for example. So we provide different features in our Cassandra service framework, the custom seed provider, as I mentioned. You can increase the cluster size as well. So for example, if you had 5 nodes in the cluster and you want to increase it to 6 nodes, you issue a post request, increase the number of nodes. What the framework does is it reconciles the tasks and sees that, oh, there are 5 nodes already available, and it starts up the 6th node, gives it the seed nodes, and bootstraps another Cassandra daemon. We allow changing any Cassandra configuration, so all of the YAML parameters can be overridden. We support automatically replacing a dead node as well, so you hit a REST endpoint and you can replace a dead node with a different node. We also support backup and restore through the framework, so there are REST endpoints for that. Also, we support cleanups and repairs, and we also support multi-data data center application through our framework. The open source version right now does not have that, but the internal branch that we have made all of the YAML parameters configurable. So that includes encryption as well, but it has not been pushed to the open source version yet. Yeah. You can create a feature request or something, and we can add that. Yes. To give a short answer to how the multi-data center support works in Mesos is that we have independent installations of Mesos in data center one and independent data center Mesos cluster in the data center two, and independent versions, independent instances of the framework as well. But the frameworks talk to each other, and the frameworks exchange seeds periodically, and that is all that is needed for Cassandra. So while bootstrapping, if you give the seeds of the other data center, the nodes can gossip the topology and figure out what the nodes are. The frameworks periodically sync with each other. It's a synchronization all the time. And Cassandra does its own replication as well. Yeah. So the execution of the scheduler is abstracted in plans, phases, and blocks. So there's one scheduling plan, which has different phases in it. And a phase consists of multiple blocks. So for example, the first phase that a scheduler goes through when it comes up is reconciliation. So talk to Mesos and figure out what tasks are already running. Then there's the deployment phase, check if the number of nodes that the configuration says are already present in the cluster. And if not, deploy them. So for example, in this diagram, the deployment phase has two nodes, two blocks, node 0 and node 1, both of which are complete. And then there are different phases like backup, restore, cleanup, repair, depending on the rest endpoints that are hit. So I'm going to show a demo. Let me see if I have enough time. I'll probably show just the demo of launching a new cluster. So this is the shell script which I used to launch the framework. It has different parameters, different environment variables for where the scheduler binary is, what the ports are for it, for the rest endpoint. The Cassandra specific ones are the Cassandra cluster name, which is the test cluster here. The different Mesos servers. So I have a vagrant environment here, and so everything is local. And Mesos servers and Zookeeper servers are configured here. The main important configuration parameters are these nodes. So for example, this is the number of nodes, and this is the number of seed nodes. So $1, I've passed it as two nodes and one seed node. And then how much CPU, memory, disk do you want to give to the Cassandra process? And several other parameters that I'm not going to go through. And so here I'm launching the so this is the Mesos UI. And there's one framework now which has been registered. This is the Cassandra test cluster. And it's going to start up. And there are two agents here, Vagrant Agent 1 and Vagrant Agent 2, which expose 4 gigabytes, 2 CPUs, and 2 gigabytes of disk. And what this is going to do is launch two nodes in these two agents, if everything works fine. Live demos, they never work. I also have a YouTube recording of it in case it doesn't work, but. At the bottom of it had passed two. So there were two nodes that are supposed to be created and one seed node. So here, node 0 is in staging state, and it's being launched on Vagrant Agent 2. In the sandbox directory, you can see the Cassandra binary, the JRE. This is the mounted volume, which is mounted on the host. So we have the commit log data and all of these directories. In this Cassandra directory, there's conf, and this YAML file is written by the framework. So all the overridden parameters are output here. And so for example, the seed provider, which I mentioned in the presentation here, this is the class name. So this is the DCO seed provider. And the seed URL is one of the parameters. So this says which are the seed nodes. And you can see that it has got one seed node, and it's launching the nodes. So node 0 is already in running state. And now you can directly use SQL SH to connect to this vagrant agent 2, giving it the host name. And node 1 will soon come up and transition into the running state as well. So both the nodes are running now. So we also have implemented the different Cassandra operations. For example, repair, which is needed to synchronize data across replicas. And Cassandra uses the last write wins policy. And what we do is we repair primary key range node by node. So on node 0, we say, OK, do a repair with just the primary key range. And in this way, we can do a repair across the cluster without affecting the performance. Also, a cleanup is a similar operation that we do, which removes the data that is not needed. For example, if you have added nodes, some of the data from other nodes has been copied, but the existing data is not removed from the previous nodes. And so cleanup is required to be done on those nodes. There's lots of different failure scenarios which we handle as well. Let me go through the experiments. So how fast can we start up clusters? There's multiple steps involved in this, as I showed in the demo. And we can basically start up clusters using the optimized offer timeout at a rate of one new node per minute. So once we roll out a node, we wait for it to transition from starting to joining to normal before we bootstrap another node. You cannot start multiple nodes concurrently in Cassandra. So we wait for the first node to transition to normal before we bring up the second node. And so what is the node density? Do you mean the hardest space or? The disk space, usually we give 2 terabytes. Memory is about 128 gigabytes on it, and we give about 100 gigabytes to the container, and I think 32 gigs to Cassandra process for the heap. The last slide actually has numbers about our production numbers. I'll get to that. Since I don't have a lot of time remaining, I'll just quickly go through the important performance numbers. So what we did is a comparison between bare metal versus Mesos managed cluster. So how much is the performance overhead of using containers? So what we see here is the read latency, and there's hardly any difference, like 0.38 milliseconds versus 0.44 milliseconds. And so there's about 5 to 10% performance overhead in latency, as well as in throughput. It's very, very similar as well. And we find similar numbers for write latency and write throughput. We are also running this across data centers, and I briefly mentioned that we sync the seeds periodically with external data centers, and the Cassandra nodes gossip the topology. We measure the asynchronous data center replication latency by writing a row in one data center using local one, and then trying to spin in a loop in the other data center and try to read it as well with local one. And what we found was our median latency was about 45 milliseconds with a round-tripping latency of 77 milliseconds. So it was slightly more than half the round-trip latency. I promised. A slide. So these are our production numbers. So we currently have about 20 clusters, which are replicating across two data centers. We have one on the West Coast and one on the East Coast. We originally had four data centers. We also had data centers in China. And we were replicating to them as well. But since we've merged with DD in China, we kind of shut down those clusters now. We have about 300 machines across these two data centers. The largest two clusters are doing more than 1 million writes per second and about 100K reads per second. One of the clusters is storing the location that is sent out every 30 seconds by the rider app as well as the driver app. And we have a talk on that tomorrow at 10 a.m. or 10:30 a.m. by Evan. And he's going to talk about how we are managing the fire hose of location data that we're getting and storing in Cassandra. The mean read latencies that we find are about 13 milliseconds, and the write latency is about 25 milliseconds. And most of our clients use local quorum consistency level. So those are the latencies that we observe. And that's it. So I'll take any questions. Yes. Yes. It's also bare metal, but it's running Mesos on it, and it's running Cassandra inside a container. So the bare metal means Cassandra is running without any container, outside the container on bare metal. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There was a considerable amount of debate that happened at Uber before Cassandra was going to be deployed. For managing all the stateless services as well. Kubernetes at that point had been shown to scale to about 500 nodes, but we had a requirement of tens of thousands of nodes, and Mesos was the only one which had scaled at that point of time. Mesos is a more mature project, and that's why they picked Mesos. But today, I think you can use Kubernetes as well to run Cassandra. They had a recent blog post where they exposed a pet set API, which is, can be used to deploy Cassandra as well.
I noticed you had in the Mesos installation. Is that what you normally use, or is that just because you're running it on your laptop?
It's just because I'm running on my laptop that I was going to show on Vagrant. It's a local environment for development and testing and debugging. Yeah. Is Uber only using Cassandra? No. Actually, Uber made their own homegrown sharded MySQL store, which is called Schemaless. There's a blog post on the engineering blog if you're interested in how Schemaless works. That's the main store right now. And the storage vision is that we'll have Schemaless and Cassandra as the two storage options within Uber. There's also some installations of React, and we're trying to move off React and use Cassandra. It's time variable. The throughput, it's sometimes higher, it's sometimes lower. You can see that it goes down as well. So there's time variability in that, and we didn't dig deeper into it.
Thank you.
The split brain issue should be something that Cassandra should handle, right? There's no difference, logically speaking, between Cassandra running on bare metal and replicating across data centers versus running inside a container. There's absolutely no difference in the logic of it. We can discuss this offline. Just a sec.
Are you using any of the workload distribution abilities of Mesos?
Yes, so we are using it for the stateless services. But right now for Cassandra, we have dedicated hosts which run different Cassandra nodes on the same machine. We are not co-locating other stateless services on top of the Cassandra nodes yet. But we plan to do that in the future. Yeah, for example, we could be running Spark jobs on the same nodes which are running Cassandra as well. But we are not doing that right now, but we plan to do it. Yeah. Okay. Last question, anybody? Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so we have one framework instance per cluster. One framework instance only manages one cluster, and we have the control plane API for which you can do a post request, and it'll spawn off a new framework instance with a different configuration.
If you have more questions, you can contact Abhishek on the hall. So thank you very much.
Thank you.